Hello, everyone, and welcome to ADC Forum's series, Surviving the Crisis and Building the Future Amidst the COVID-19 Pandemic. Today, we're going to be talking about China in the post-COVID-19 world. And it's a real pleasure to have with us a very long-standing supporter and friend of the ADC, Ronnie Chan. Ronnie is the chairman of the Hang Lung Group and the Hang Lung Properties Company, both from Hong Kong, which he founded back in 1960. He expanded the business to mainland China in 1992, and it focuses on developing, owning, and managing world-class commercial complexes in key cities. He's also the founder of, or the co-founder of Morningside, which is an investments company focused on venture capital and private equity in manufacturing, telecommunications, media and technology, as well as biotechnology. And he's a major philanthropist in both China and the United States in the sciences and music. Ronnie's been active in many educational and non-profit organizations, a number of which he founded, focused on both cultural issues and international relations, as well as he's also been part of the international faculty of the ADC Forum and also a number of educational institutions, non-profit organizations and think tanks. Organizations such as the Peterson Institute for International Economics, the World Economic Forum, the East-West Center, the Indian School of Business, Yale University, Tsinghua University, University of Southern California. He's a frequent speaker and commentator in leading publications such as the Financial Times, the International Herald Tribune, Fortune, the Asian Wall Street Journal, the Far Eastern Economic Review, Japan Times. And I think it's a real pleasure to have Ronnie today, because he really provides an incredible overview of what's happening in the world with his deep business expertise from both United States and China, with the obviously focus of his companies being based in Hong Kong. And I think just at this time of the pandemic, and also what's going on with the trade war, you know, really excited to hear what Ronnie has to say in terms of some of these issues. So without further ado, if we can hand over to you, perhaps if you'd like to outline your view of what's going on at the moment in terms of COVID-19 and also some of the underlying dynamics in terms of US, China, the world, both in terms of the political situation, the economic and the business situation, and how we're sort of going to navigate forward as leaders of organizations in the private sector and businesses and industry, as well as in terms of the broader geopolitical landscape. So Ronnie, over to you.
Thank you, Anton. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining this session. I'm surprised that 100 people signed up. Who knows who Ronnie Chan is? Who cares who Ronnie Chan is? Especially in the West, those who know me know that my views are often very, very controversial. So I'm just surprised that some people still want to listen to me. I assume that that's because of Michael and because of Anton and not because of me. But anyway, you are stumped. You can leave anytime anyway. So let me just speak to the air if it's necessary. I tried to get on at 11:56, and then I was rejected. He says this is an internal meeting, and I was rejected until I had to do this and that in order to. Now I'm using my cell phone instead of my big iPad, so I cannot see everybody too well. Doesn't matter. So let me just begin by, I was asked by Anton to make a few opening remarks. I really prefer to have more interactions with everybody, if you like. The first thing I want to mention is that is to answer a question that a journalist asked me one time after the COVID-19 started. And that is, he said, when we are faced with such black swan events, what shall we do? My answer is, sir, this is not a black swan event. If you think that this is a black swan event, then I think you will be really nastily surprised. Because if you were to look at human history, every 10 years or so, there's always some serious epidemic or even pandemics that hits the world. For example, 2003, the SARS that was started in southern China. Then you have, that was 2003. 2009, you have H1N1, the bird flu that started either in Mexico or in North America, I'm not 100% sure. And that killed even more people. The SARS, the percentage of infected that got that died was about 9.8%. Whereas the H1N1, it was something like 17.8%. And whereas this, the COVID-19 is only, 5% roughly, when you take the whole world together. And so it is really, it's not that deadly. However, I refer everyone to the work of a professor from Duke Medical School 10 years ago. He stated that he warned the world that pandemics will become a lot more and more serious in the coming years. And he has two reasons. The first reason is because of massive, quick urbanization, where many places that are not ready for population, human population, are suddenly populated. And so a lot of the infrastructures are not there, and hence it's very easy to have viruses go wild. That's number one. Number two, transportation, of course, the global travel that spreads it everywhere. That which makes this time different from the last two times, and by the way, previous to SARS of 2003, from what I have studied for the previous 30-40 years, maybe public health wasn't as good in those days. I'm sure that is part of the case. Some of you know that I've been very much involved in public health for about 40 years or so. And some of you know about my involvement with the Harvard Public School. And that is named after my late father. So my involvement in this field has been a long-standing one. I'm not an expert on that, but nonetheless, I have been interested in this topic. So whereas before SARS, the best case scenario was that it killed 34% of the population, and the worst was 88%. And whereas SARS was 9-point-some, and H1N1 was 17.8, and this time only about 5-6%. So this time is actually a lot better. However, that which is bad is, of course, the
asymptomatic
nature of this virus. That is, in the case of SARS, unless it stays in the human body for some time and then it comes out. And once you have the symptoms, then it becomes contagious. So that's why it didn't spread so much, because those people who are traveling without being sick yet, they are not contagious. But this time, because of the
asymptomatic
of it, that is, even when you have it without having the symptom yet, it can be contagious. So in a sense, I think the COVID-19 is it's fortunate for mankind. I know that is very unkind thing to say, but look at it objectively. Human beings are very lucky to have the COVID-19 instead of something else, because although it's sneaky, meaning it is contagious even without the symptom, it is not that deadly. Think about next time. What if you have another case which is at the same time contagious and
asymptomatic,
like COVID-19, and much more deadly, like Ebola? right? So I think that my first point is, it's not black swan. We are lucky to have this case, which is not that deadly, so that hopefully mankind will learn from it, so that next time, if something worse comes, we will be able to handle it. That's my first point. My second point, Anton, just tell me to shut up, okay? If I speak too much, if you want to anytime turn to Q&A. The second point I want to make is that the world is seeing a double whammy. We're not just seeing COVID-19. A few years before, already there was another issue in the world that is an overlay to the COVID-19 situation of today, and that is the U.S.-China relationship going sour. Now, to be sure, the U.S.-China relationship did not get sour under Trump. It got worse under Trump. If I were to characterize the U.S.-China relationship since World War II, I would say three incidents define a turning point. First one was Korean War. We all know what happened. U.S.-China relationship went to hell. Number two, Nixon visiting China in 1971, 72, around there, early 70s. That suddenly turned the U.S.-China relationship to heaven. And then the third one is June 4th, 1989, when China had the student movement. And from that point on, the U.S.-China relationship did not go to hell. Thank God George H.W. Bush was the president at that time. And you remember that he sent Scowcroft, General Scowcroft, to Beijing quite secretly, and he was greatly criticized for it. But I think that for the world, that was really a very fortunate thing, such that U.S.-China relationship didn't go to hell overnight. And America has a tendency to see everything very, very black or very, very white. Unlike the Asian, who tend to see things in a gray fashion, which, let's face it, 90% of the world is not black or white, it's more gray. Anyway, so you have the gradual decline of U.S.-China relationship from 1989. Now, that is over 30 years ago. And so what Trump did was only on the foundation of what was already a deteriorating relationship, that it just added the last straw, so to speak, on the camel's back. And so today, we have a terrible U.S.-China relationship, just like in the previous event that I mentioned, the Korean War, the Nixon-China visit, and then June 4th, 1989. Each of those lasted 15, 20, 30 years. So in other words, if anyone is expecting U.S.-China relationship to get any better anytime soon, I would say history does not seem to confirm that. So we should be ready for a prolonged period of terrible relationship between U.S.-China relations. So the COVID-19, it comes on top of the double whammy of on top of the bad U.S.-China relations. I'll cite you some examples. I just got a question from Anton this morning, how the Chinese don't like the fact that Australian is checking on where is the origin of the pandemic. Personally, why not? Let's study that. But on the other hand, have we ever studied the origin that well of H1N1? Did we ever sue America or Mexico for N1H1? Now, then the issue of China hiding the real situation. Now, tell me, which country does not hide the situation? Remember what Trump and Mike Pence said about the COVID-19? They knew, because you remember that senator, where is he from? I forgot. North Carolina or somewhere, who told his supporters to be very careful because he serves in this committee of the U.S. Congress. You better be very careful. These are his financial supporters. Huh? Be very careful because this thing is really deadly. It's going to really affect the economy. And then he himself go out and sold something like $6 million of equity. So he knew the facts. And then when he came out, he told the people that, oh, this is nothing. There's no big problem. Right? Mike Pence said what Donald Trump said. Everybody lied. And by the way, oftentimes for good reasons. You don't want to scare the population, especially when you're not prepared. You can have really serious social problems if you tell the truth. For example, perhaps it's because America did not have all the face masks, did not have all the ventilators, did not have all the equipment. So what do? Tell the world and tell America how bad it is? And you can have really a serious social issue. So everybody lies. For anybody to say somebody with some country don't lie on this issue is himself either a liar or an ignorant man. It's just simple fact. And you check history. Every case where there is a pandemic, all the government react exactly the same way. So now you have the U.S.-China relationship having turned bad. On top of it, and with America and the West controlling the media, China, this is absolutely, you know, you can roll over China, run over them with the media. And so, you know, a lot of things today are really on the surface, one thing. Underneath is another thing. Why did the Chinese lie about the facts? Who didn't? America is the first one to have committed that. And as I said, some oftentimes are good reasons. So anyway, we are looking at a very, very nasty situation. And not too long ago, I gave a talk on 10 big problems in the world. And then I overlay the COVID-19 with it. And I say, gosh, every one of those things will be changed to the worst because of the COVID-19. For example, I just mentioned one or two, Anton, maybe I should stop. Huh? For example, deglobalization. The world is already in the process of deglobalizing. And by the way, anybody who's surprised by this, don't read history. Globalization always fluctuates. It undulates over time. 2,000 years ago, you have the Silk Road. What is that? That is a globalization of its time. And then for whatever reason, that was stopped. And then later it starts, and then it stopped. So for any one of us to expect globalization, and we all are, many of us are beneficiaries of globalization. And so we begin to think that, hey, this thing is never going to end. Well, ladies and gentlemen, may I suggest that we read a little history? It always ends. The way it ends may differ, but it always ends. So already the world is, you may say, deglobalization, deglobalizing, and the COVID-19 absolutely pushed it to the other extreme. You know, now you say that, hey, we should not, you know, rely on the source of, relying on one country for the supply of whatever, such as face masks or whatever. You should have been smart enough to know that from day one. Why didn't you do it? Well, because of good economic reasons. That is the cheapest place you can get it, and you are not smart enough to figure out that I should go to India or Bangladesh or Pakistan or somewhere, or my own country, I'm American, and build my own face mask factory. Now, it sounds pretty crazy today. Do you think that America still make clothing? And face masks is a kind of, you know, high-tech clothing, right? So America hardly makes that anymore. So are you going to make that? No. Until something comes in to spark the necessity for change. And so COVID-19 is just one of those things that absolutely will exacerbate much of the 10 issues that I presented in one of my earlier speeches. So, and then, of course, globalization has two aspects to it, the political aspect and then the economic aspect, and the two are obviously related. And so the supply chain is going to change greatly, as we all know. So that's on the economic side. And then you have the global, you have the deglobalization in a political sense. I mean, take for example, listen to what Macron has been saying for the last 2 years. Listen to what Angela Merkel has been saying for the last 3-4 years. And you can see that America is no longer a trusted partner as before. And I have long said this. I have said this for 10 years. Go back to my previous speeches. That America is a country that was founded in isolationism. A lot of people know that. And we cannot imagine that America will go back to isolationism, because in your lifetime and mine, America has been very open to the international system. In fact, it is a leader of the free market economy and the perpetrator of a lot of those Bretton Woods and the United Nations and so forth. But just go back to read history. America is founded on isolationism. Remember the Monroe Doctrine of 1823? Remember the Roosevelt Corollary of 1903, I think it was? Remember the exceptionalism of the late 19th century, as well as early 20th century, or up to today, in fact? America never joined the League of Nations, although it was at the, although it, you know, proposed it, I think, but it never joined it. And then the isolationism of the 1920s that led to the Great Depression of 29 to 33, 1922 to 1933. So America has this streak of isolationism. And right now we are seeing that happening as well. So instead of a double whammy, we have a triple whammy. And now, obviously, the fact that Europe has a problem with America doesn't mean that Europe automatically will become a good friend of China. That's logically, it doesn't stand. Okay, it may or it may not, right? So I'm just keep China out of the picture. I'm just talking about the United States and Europe. And so America has been cutting down its own moral authority. After World War II, America has all the moral authority in the free world. And yet, unlike the British, who, in my opinion, is far smarter in diplomacy and handling these things, for example, it kept itself for 200 years in India. And they don't have the military might to maintain the colony of India. And so diplomatically, you have to be very smart. And you have to build up your own moral authority for whatever reason, for good reason, bad reason, honest, dishonest, hypocrisy, doesn't matter. They needed it. And so they ruled. You know how many British were there in India during those 200 years? Less than 200,000. And only about 10% of them are officers and soldiers. So how do 20,000 people rule a country at that time, India, of 300 million people? So you have to be very careful diplomatically. Whereas America doesn't need to be, because America has the biggest muscle. My muscle is my last resort. So if diplomacy fails, I will scare the heck out of it with my military. And so America is never particularly good in diplomacy. And so as a result, America has been cutting down its own moral authority over the last 50 years. And with Trump, it certainly doesn't help. It certainly, you know, make America even lose the moral authority or moral leadership even more. So America will retreat to itself. Europe would have to fend for itself. Macron and Merkel have both said that they should rearm. And I bet you anything that in the next 5-7 years, Europe will begin to rearm. Although Angela Merkel, in her swan song speech, I think about 4 months ago, said that it will be very difficult under the present circumstance, under the leadership of America. But that said, you never underestimate the foolishness of America. Just like let no one underestimate the power of America. Also, let no one underestimate the foolishness of America. And it can do something very quickly and further deteriorate its own moral leadership, in which case it will scare the heck out of the Europeans, and then the opportunity will be there for Europe to rearm. So allow me to just say one word about Australia. Anton, because your last question to me was about Australia. I have to be very, very careful. I love Australians. My brother is right now hiding from, he's a Canadian, but he's hiding now somewhere outside of Sydney. He got stuck there, couldn't get out. And he just rented a place. But, you know, Australia, as far as I can tell, is the three best friends of the United States. Who are they? Anton, who are they?
the three best friends of the United States?
Yeah.
Right. it's a pretty Anglo-Saxon sort of worldview you're pointing to, is that right?
Yeah. Australia, Britain, and Japan. For different reasons. I think recent history of the last one century tell us why each of these three are good friends of the United States. Australia is being blessed by being far away from anybody. And you have a lot of natural resources. You can live on for a long time by yourself. You only have, 25 million people? How many, Anton?
26 million people.
26, 27 million. And you can live for very, very happily. But that said, you still need to sell your natural resources to somebody. Hmm. And so I think that of the three, Australia are probably in the best position. Japan is probably in the most awkward position. But whatever it is, I'll be happy to bet you that Europe, the rest of Europe, outside of Britain, I don't even know whether I should call Britain Europe anymore, geographically sure it is. But at least continental Europe will drift away from the United States. And then the whole world is going to be a different world. And these are not things that happen overnight. It has been all gradually happening since World War II. And a COVID-19, no matter how you look at it, will only push the world further in that direction. I don't want to answer your last question yet, because it's not a foolish question, but to me, it matters a lot to you all in Australia.
The one about the current tensions?
Sorry?
The one about the current tensions in China-Australia.
Yeah.
Well, thanks very much, Ronnie. You've gone through a range of issues, and let's go back and pick up a few of those. I think one thing that you do extremely well, you mentioned at the beginning that you would be controversial. I think what you also do is kind of present a perspective and a side of the stories that you're telling that, you know, many people perhaps forget or don't necessarily keep front of mind. So I think that sort of perspective that you bring through both the depth and breadth of your observations and experiences is quite important. And I think before we go back into the specifics around Australia and some of the other specific issues you mentioned, let's go back to what you mentioned right at the beginning around the virus, around COVID-19, and let's start at the sort of global level. So what are your thoughts on not necessarily looking at countries for the moment, but the global situation and the global administration and observation and investigation and management of issues such as this pandemic? Do you want to speak a little about the role of the WHO and what you think has been going on there? Because as you know, the US and Australia also, there have been calls for a review of WHO powers, one to increase them in the sense of having, if you like, weapons inspector type authority to look at issues such as pandemics, similar to the nuclear weapon inspector powers, and also I guess the issue around the trusted nature of the organization, its powers, and what you see as its role going forward.
Okay, first of all, I hope, ladies and gentlemen, that we can be extraordinarily clear-headed and objective about things. Oftentimes, what I say offends a lot of people. I know that. So, Anton, you and Michael are taking a lot of risk by inviting me to speak here. And let's be extraordinarily objective about it. Much of what you hear today coming from America and many other countries, without thinking through issues, just buy into America. is pretty ridiculous. I set you one. The United States want to send a team of American experts to China to study. Okay? Given today's terrible relationship between US and China, and given all the lies that have been propagated in America about China in the last several years, especially under Trump, you think that China in its right mind would say yes? And by the way, in early February, the WTO led a delegation, 13 of them led a delegation of international experts, including several Americans. And they went into China for, I think, something like, 2 weeks, 12 or 14 days, 14 days, I think. They went to Wuhan, they went to three other places all over China, led by a WHO Deputy Secretary General. That fellow's name is, I think, Bruce Elwood. And he gave a report in Geneva. And they were given access to everything they want to see, and these are international experts. I think there was, they may even be an Australian on the team, and then you have Japanese and British and Africa, wherever else. And so it is not that Americans are not allowed in. They were part of the team already. Which is more fair, a WHO team or an American team? You think the American team will dare to say anything other than what Trump says? Trump fires everybody who disagrees with him. And do you think that such a team will be able to produce an objective report? China got to be stupid, and they are also sometimes very stupid, by the way, in order to let them in. A purely American team, right? So it's all political overlay to everything that is happening here. And now on the WHO, I'm no expert of the WHO. I just have a little bit of dealing with them over the years. And, you know, the way America is treating WHO today is really quite amazing. As an American, I find it, I won't say shameful, but almost shameful to see what, you know, this president has been saying and doing. And you know, to cut the support at this juncture is really unconscionable. And so, you know, whether WHO is good, is not good, I'm no, in no position to judge. Are they pro-China? Are they against China? I think the rest of the world will have their own judgment. And I think one way to look at it is, are other countries continue going to support WHO? And I suspect that I can hardly think of any other major countries in the world would not support WHO. It is really insane to do something like that. And then I heard that there were, 17 or 18 senators and congressmen wrote a letter to the president supporting his decision. Now, where does that, when was it initiated? Was it in the White House or was it in the Congress? Who knows, right? But whatever it is, I think, again, back to what I was saying, what the way America is treating WHO is forcing America to lose moral leadership and hence into isolationism, which to me is not good for the world. I wish America would not do that. I wish America would work with the international community, including China, in many, many world issues. At the end of the day, however, I don't think that it's a lost cause in terms of U.S.-China relationship. But that said, that's another story.
I mean, you do paint quite a sort of declining picture of U.S.-China relationship, and also talking about the increasing trend to deglobalization. Do you see that occurring at the level of global governance, specifically in terms of organizations like the WHO, and the ability of the world to deal in a coordinated fashion with issues like climate change? Or do you see it happening more in terms of the relationships between countries and in terms of international trade?
Well, one of the 10 issues that I gave in that talk of mine was the waning of international institutions. That said, personally, my judgment is, damn if you do, damn if you don't. You have them, you are in trouble. You, without them, you're in bigger trouble. So personally, you ask me, I say, keep all those. From United Nations to World Bank to IMF to World Health Organization to a World Food Program. Now, that's another big one, by the way, the World Food situation. And to the all the Bretton Woods institutions, right? And so personally, I like to keep them. But I think that a lot of people don't know this. Do you know that America has always been in arrears paying United Nations dues?
Yeah.
You know, 20-some years ago, I was hosted by Mitch McConnell and his wife, Elaine, in the Kentucky Derby. And I have no interest in horse racing. But since Mitch and Elaine invited me, I went. That afternoon, the two of them drove me around town, Louisville, Kentucky, to see the city. Hate to say this. Frankly, it's a small city. I'm not that interested. My interest was to convince Mitch to pay the United Nations dues. I totally failed. A few years ago, I wrote to him and said, Mitch, sorry, I failed 20 years ago, and I'm still failing today, meaning you are still not paid on time. Okay? So I think that, you know, that if America ever withdraw from the international organizations, and there will be that tendency. It may not fully withdraw, but there will be that strong tendency. It's already, because America is so powerful, it's already enough to really do damage to the international system. And so the question is, will China take its place? First of all, China does not want to take its place. Anybody who thinks that China wants to take its place, as far as I'm concerned, you don't know China. China does not want to take its place. China just want to be one among many. Want to be respected, obviously, because of its history being, you know, overrun by foreign powers. So who will be the leader? There'll be no leader. America is only one. And if America doesn't fulfill that role, now obviously, for realistic reason as well as for protocol reasons, America will have to share power. This is no longer 1945, 1946. So you have to give China room, just like you have to give Japan room, you have to give India room, you have to give EU room, and even Australia, 27 million people. Yeah. And so, but America is not smart enough to do what is, to me, the reasonable thing to do. And as a result, those institutions are falling apart now. There are other reasons. I'll just like one, Anton. And that is, conceptually, it is impossible for those institutions to adequately address world problems because organizations, by definition, is static. Once it is set, it is set. It doesn't change easily. And hence, there's a lot of management guru saying how, you know, now talking about organizations that can evolve and change, all that stuff. Hey, keep doing it, trying it, okay? But for the time being, you cannot change that fast. And yet, the world changes very fast. And so the change of the world is fast, far faster than the organizational change of any of those global organizations. So it's obviously going to, you know, not work in many, many ways. But as I said earlier, not having them is going to be worse, in my opinion. Sure. And so, on balance, have them.
Ronnie, in terms of your characterization of China wanting to be one nation among many, I think the commentary that's come through the Australian media and through the Chinese ambassador's comments the last 24 hours, there's been, I guess, concern that China doesn't necessarily want that sort of relationship with the rest of the world or specifically Australia, because there's been talk of almost warnings around trade boycotts across a range of Australia's largest sectors, from education to beef to you know, a number of other export goods and services that Australia produces. And I just, as a response to you know, Australia sort of wanting to pursue this investigation in terms of the origins, trying to go on a truth-finding mission in terms of the origins of COVID-19. You know, the view that there's a view that this is not necessarily a sort of proportionate or appropriate response to that desire for an independent inquiry. What are your thoughts there?
First of all, China is new to the international stage. Its reform really only officially started in 1979, but really by 1996, it didn't even have a central bank. Okay, so you're really only talking about a 20, 25-year history. And so in the international arena, China is like a Jersey girl, sorry for the word, a Jersey girl on the world stage, suddenly with all the light shining at it. And frankly, it has a little stage fright and really don't know what to do. They're trying different things. Sometimes they're too soft. Sometimes they're too strong. And so now they're playing, I read what you just sent me, Anton, about, you know, sending the students, they're not coming, we don't want to buy Australian goods and this and that. Well, to say that out loud like that seems to be a little bit on the rough side, but I thought that Australians, the outback is a little rough too, just like in America and the Wild West. So I thought that you guys should be used to it. And let me ask you one thing. Which country does not play the economic card or the military card or the political card if you have them? Some countries are too small. They can't play any cards. If you have a card, you play it. It just matters whether you play it in a overtly or covertly, in a more with a silver glove or with your bare fist. And China is pretty bad at that. They just don't know how to do it. And the reality is, everybody plays it. And let me tell you what happened to me and your ambassador to Beijing, Graham Fletcher. He came to see me in January, brought by the Consul General from Australia to Hong Kong. She was a very hardworking consul general. And from time to time, she called me up and wanted to talk about this and that, which is, you know, I assume that she calls many people. She's really a hardworking lady, Michaela Browning. But anyway, so she brought Graham Fletcher to Hong Kong. Michaela has left Hong Kong already. And so we had a lot of discussion. And he told me, we just don't like the fact that China is always telling our people that you are hurting our feeling. You're hurting the feeling of the Chinese people by doing this or by doing that. Okay? So I said, well, around that time, that was when the Britain accepted to use Huawei for part of the 5G. Okay? To my knowledge, it's not the main part, but it doesn't matter. They accepted some of the Huawei 5G equipment. And Trump came out and bashed Britain, totally in front of everybody, bashed. So I wrote to Graham Fletcher, I wrote to Michaela Browning. I said, sorry, now I'm going to offend a lot of people from Australia, okay? Anton, one thing good about electronic meeting is you cannot throw tomatoes at me. Just don't get my back.
You've said the expectations, I think they're waiting for it. Go ahead.
And I said, are you like to suffer pain? What's that word? Masochistic, right? Isn't it?
Masochistic, yeah.
Okay. I said, every ally of America have been, just like Britain right now, been on the short end of the stick. That America use all kinds of power and bring it to bear on any country, including its allies, that does something it doesn't like. Maybe Australia always find it to be in alignment with America, and you have not suffered that, I doubt. I'm 70. I wasn't born yesterday. And so I said, apparently your ambassador to Beijing is, if that's the right word, meaning light suffering, huh? Is that masochism? Like to be beaten up by somebody. China say, you're hurting my feeling. Please change. America said, I don't like what you do. I hit you on the head. So is that what you like? And at the end, I was very kind to Graham Fletcher. I said, at the end of the day, it is really cultural. Something that you mentioned earlier. Let's put it all on the table and be among friends with rational people. Look at the facts. The fact is, history, culture, background, language, all those things play into it. And there's no such thing as right or wrong. Well, right or wrong is secondary in something like this. Culture is thousands of years or hundreds of years in the case of Australia and America. But nonetheless, it comes from somewhere, from Europe. And so, you know, that is something that my hope, and I have been laboring on this for 30-some years, trying to better U.S.-China relationship by helping both sides understand not just the economic and political realities of the day, such as all the things that the Chinese ambassador is supposed to have said. Right? Okay, fine. You know, maybe he shouldn't have said that. I don't know. But anyway, but, you know, like it or not, economics and politics and military are realities among nations today, wherever you are from. And anybody who has those cards will play those cards, not least of which America. So I just hope that the Chinese will play a little bit smarter next time.
So Ronnie, how are businesses supposed to navigate, you know, the situation amidst these various political, military, and other diplomatic cards being played between nations? You know, you're looking at, I guess, the retail sector in a very focused way. You're also a technology investor. I mean, what do you see as the sort of trends happening through COVID-19 and beyond that are affected by the pandemic itself?
Well, even before the pandemic, I think just the U.S.-China relationship itself, America is surely pushing the world toward a multi-system technology world. Meaning that, you remember in the old days, I think most of us are old enough to remember CDMA, and what's the other one, the European, GSM, was it? Yep. The cell phone, right? Mm-hmm. You have different systems. And when you go to Korea, when you go to Japan, you have, at the airport, you buy a phone, rent a phone. Well, the worst case scenario is that we may go back to such a world. Hopefully, there will be conversion systems. It makes it very, very inefficient. But that said, if you are China, think about it. America decided not to sell the Android to China anymore after a period of time. And so it hurts China. So it forced China to create its own Android. Now it's out, right? what's it called? Harmony or something like that. And whatever it is, you are forcing China to come up with their own system. And then if you were the Chinese, you would be thinking, God damn it, all my cell phone, all the Gmail accounts are totally transparent to the U.S. government. You said, no. It's only transparent to Google, the company. Are you a 15-year-old young man, young woman who is that naive? You think that government want information, they can't get it. And so, you know, so the Chinese are saying, God damn it, we may as well take advantage of this to develop our own system. Hopefully, it's less dependent on the United States. Because after all our information are known to America, as long as you use their system. And I remember watching a video of a journalist in Washington, D.C. He spent 2-3 hours with two cell phones, and each of those cell phones had turned off, and one even have an airplane mode on. And he went around the city, went to the great National Cathedral, went to the library, went to the hospital, went to the cafe, wherever he went. And after 2-3 hours, he came back to his office, the journalist, it's a big media company, and then with technology, download everything. It tells him to the minute, to the second where he went. You are walking forward. You get into a car. The car drove for 3 blocks, turn right 3 blocks, turn left 2 blocks or whatever. And then you were at this place for how long, you were at that place. It knows everything. And so they are saying China is putting all the camera, right? Hey, a loud mouth like me don't like to be watched either. But that said, You think America doesn't know what you're doing? Are you, again, sorry to say, the 15-year-old young man and young woman? And so, you know, and by the way, I also predict that very soon, in order to fight terrorism, in order to fight COVID-19 and the like, in order to fight many crimes, sorry to say, once you have the cell phone, you open up a whole Pandora box. In the old days, terrorism is one man kill one man. Now it's one man pushing a button on his computer and kill a city. And so if you don't use technology to counter these kind of terrible acts, you are foolish and you're not doing your job. And so privacy is something that has to be totally redefined.
You've spoken about the position of Australia between China and the US in terms of the relationships between the countries. What do you see as the future for Hong Kong?
Well, I wrote two pieces recently as chairman's letter from the chairman to shareholders. I run two publicly listed company, and you know, it's very, very long, and I detail everything there. So Anton, if you're interested, just download it on Hong Kong. And 6 months ago, I wrote a piece on U.S.-China relations, and this time mostly in Hong Kong. I think Hong Kong really run the risk of losing its brightness as the pearl of the Orient. But on the other hand, neither will Hong Kong disappear. I think that in terms of financial service, Hong Kong will be able to maintain its position, mainly because there's very little alternative. And frankly, there's no better alternative. And then beyond the financial service, I think the retail will absolutely suffer. And thanks to the social unrest late last year. And I think Hong Kong people have managed to damage themselves in a serious way. But that said, in terms of retail, China is doing very, very well. In fact, my company's property in mainland China, especially on the luxury side, is doing very, very well since this month.
Mm. Oh, that's good to hear, Ronnie. And you spoke about, you know, perhaps countries should have been a bit more prepared in terms of their critical supply for medical products, engaging with potential manufacturing countries such as Bangladesh or India. I mean, if you're advising businesses, whether in the US or Australia or in ASEAN, in terms of whether they should manufacture in China or kind of have a diversified supply chain, I mean, it sounds like it's pretty obvious what you would say the answer would be. I mean, what are your final remarks in terms of what businesses should be focusing on in terms of positioning themselves in the world post COVID-19?
Well, first of all, I think that the spreading around of the supply chain is inevitability, although it will take some time, because it's not easy to duplicate what China has done. And China recognizes that, and they have to prepare for it themselves. I think the problem, especially for the smaller countries, America has a big enough domestic market. EU as a whole is big enough a market. China is big enough a market. But many smaller countries, I can see, may be hurt. You can see me now, but Anton and Michael are good friends of mine for many, many years. In the case of Michael, decades. You know, I'm a small guy. Being a small guy, you always have to learn to survive. And there are things that smaller countries can do in order to survive in the future world. But the criteria for success of the old days may not be exactly the same as those of tomorrow. So I think that I believe that hard asset in the right place is still a good hedge. Inflation may come back because all these countries are. By the way, everybody is sin in this sin of QE2, QE1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Every country. China is one of the worst, by the way. And Japan, US, Europe, everybody. I don't know about Australia. And now with all that money in order to fight COVID-19, sooner or later, that money is going to come back to haunt us somewhere. And so I think that, you know, hard asset will still be good. In terms of business, the big countries, they can still do technological development because you can amortize the high cost of technology development over a big market. The smaller markets, well, not smaller market, the smaller, yeah, Africa and South America and those places are potential markets that will be fought after by the big boys, meaning the United States and China. America would have to look at itself and say, can I amortize the technology investment in a smaller world, in a much smaller world, by America's own choice? Because, you know, you want to make China an enemy, so the world is bifurcated, and, you know, you have a much smaller world than before. And don't assume that Western Europe, continental Western Europe, will necessarily side with the United States. That is not a foregone conclusion. Anybody who thinks it is, I suggest that you read history again. So anyway, so I think that the world will be so troubled, Anton. So I'm frankly, I don't have a grandchild. My wife, my son is married. Michael, you know him well, my son. Whether I have grandchildren, I really don't care. And my wife also. Because they will be, if I have grandchild, they will be born, grandchildren, they will be born in such a troubled world. I really hate to see my loved one, if I have a grandchild, would have to face that kind of a world. And so, Anton, I never like to be old, but I think your father is more lucky than you are, because he is, whatever, 25, 30 years older than you, and you, younger generation, have to face a very uncertain world.
Well, Ronnie, thank you very much for sharing your thoughts today. It's been a real pleasure talking to you, as always. I think you've probably fulfilled the expectations you set earlier about being controversial to people listening. So thanks very much once again for this conversation on China in the future. Do you want to make one further remark?
No, just one request.
Yes.
If you ever get feedback from your members, ADC members, by all means, summarize it and send it to me, because I want to know what people down under are thinking. Whether they agree, they don't agree, I really don't care. But if they may have some points that I haven't thought of and that may well be true, that I need to know. So I would appreciate, Anton, if you receive any feedback, summarize it and send it to me.
Sure, Ronnie. So as Ronnie said, if you have any kind of thoughts or reflections after the end of this conversation, please send them in to us. We can have a chat about them. We can sort of take them a bit further with Ronnie as well. But thanks again for joining us. Thank you, Ronnie. And it's been, you know, very interesting series. And I think your insights on China are very timely as well. Thanks again.